the GS. I'm thrilled to be here with Karlie Kloss. She doesn't need an introduction, but I'm gonna introduce her anyway. As you all know, she is one of the most famous supermodels in the world. Outside of modeling, she's an avid coder. We're gonna talk a lot about that today. She's also now host and executive producer of Project Runway on Bravo. So, okay, so we'll start at the beginning. Let's start with your path to modeling.
Yes.
So you grew up in St. Louis.
I grew up in St. Louis.
You originally wanted to be a doctor and follow in your father's footsteps?
Yes, so I'm one of four daughters, and my dad's an ER doc, and I always imagined that that would be my path. Like, that's what I saw as kind of a career that you could really help other people, and I love science. From an early age, I really kind of had this, like, deep instilled kind of passion and love for science and math, and they were kind of languages that explained the world around me and came really naturally to me. My mom's an artist, and I always kind of identified as like a math and science person and like clearly not a creative person. So it's really ironic to me that my career kind of has taken the path that it has. But yeah, I grew up in St. Louis, and I just had a really awesome normal childhood. And it's kind of crazy because one day I was walking in the mall, I'm 13 years old, and I am stopped and asked if I'm interested in modeling. And at that time, that is so far removed from my world that I'm not interested. And fast forward, I'm a part of this like charity runway show, and there's scouts in the audience. I get scouted, I sign with an agency. I don't really think anything about it. My life is still like just school and being a tall, lanky teenager, which is not fun. And when I'm 15 years old, the same exact week that I start high school, I walk in New York Fashion Week for Calvin Klein. I book this exclusive, and it just kind of immediately puts me on the map in this really high fashion, fast-paced world. Yeah. And for the next 4 years, I'm kind of juggling this double life. I feel like a lot of you are my age, so maybe you'll get this reference. But like a Hannah Montana kind of like double life. And I just had this kind of surreal double life through my high school years of kind of being a normal girl going to like lame, you know, school parties and like doing my chemistry homework and worrying about like finals, but then also on the weekends and, you know, flying to Paris for Couture Fashion Week and working with Vogue and, you know, working with all the best in the fashion industry. But I always thought of it as kind of an after-school hobby, not like my career.
So listen, one of the biggest honors in the industry is to be on the cover of Vogue. You've been on the cover over 40 times, 42, I think.
Okay, there we go.
I lost count. It's real. So the magazine's legendary former fashion director, Tawny Goodman, said, quote, about Karlie, she has the best kind of ambition, which propels her forward, but in a generous way. She understands the power of success. What do you think she meant by that, and what does success mean to you?
That's really kind. I feel really grateful. I mean, truly, I think I feel like, you know, my life has happened in such a way that I kind of don't believe it sometimes. You know, I feel just a profound kind of sense of gratitude, and I feel I've always kind of taken this opportunity that I have through this career in fashion and as a model, and always wanted to do more with it. That was always something that's kind of been a driving force for me, and I think the idea of like success, for me, success is kind of always growing, is the idea of kind of always pushing myself to learn more, to do more, to help others. And I feel like, you know, through this career in fashion and as a model, I've been able to kind of do all the things that I love and kind of bring it together.
Okay, so that's a perfect segue to coding.
Yeah.
So, you know, modeling, coding, they're very different, I imagine.
Yeah, a little bit.
How did you develop this love of coding? Where does that come from? Is that, like, have you always loved coding?
No, I mean, like I said, I was always really kind of interested in math and science and business, actually, too. And I don't know, I think, so when I was, I think I must have been like 21 years old. And I graduated from high school in St. Louis. I came to New York. I was full-time modeling now. And really, on paper, I had everything that I had ever set out, you know, that my bucket list of items. Photographers to work with, covers to shoot. Like, I felt like I really had accomplished a lot of them, and yet at the same time felt really kind of unfulfilled and unchallenged. It was a real turning point for me, because on the outside it kind of looked like I had it all, and internally I was kind of feeling really empty. That summer, decided to just apply to NYU and see if I could get in. And I also took a coding class at the school called the Flatiron School. And I just was really interested in kind of understanding what this skill was, that only a certain select group of like highly intellectual people, primarily men, know, and why I don't know it, why I didn't learn it, and if to see if it's actually impossible to learn. I love challenging myself, and I love learning new things, so I thought, maybe I'll give it a try. And I took this boot camp, and it kind of opened my eyes to the power of this skill, and that it really framed it for me as a very creative skill. And for me, that was really exciting. I saw it as a language. It's a very logic-based language. Yeah. And I got really excited by kind of the possibilities, the infinite possibilities of what could be built, what kind of solutions to problems that I was experiencing, or, you know, ideas that I had that I could actually build them. And I kind of, at that same time that I was feeling really kind of burnt out and a little bit empty in my career, connected these dots, and I kind of had this aha moment of realizing I have this audience of young women, and I have a voice to these young women who are looking to me, and I want to tell them something that actually can be meaningful in some way, and point them in a direction that I think can be valuable. And this was a skill that I thought could be really valuable in the world today, and kind of in this changing landscape of like technology being interwoven into every industry. That was 5 years ago, 6 years ago that I took the class, and then that following spring I started a scholarship program, and basically I just underwrote a scholarship for 20 students, and I put it out on my social media, and I said, anybody who's interested in learning how to code, you know, apply with the YouTube video, and we would love to have you in the classroom this summer. And that was in 2015, and we had thousands of applications for those 20 spots. And that was 5 years ago, and now we have camps across the United States. We teach thousands of girls how to code. We have a community of really engaged young women. And just for those of you who aren't familiar, Code with Klossy is, we essentially run summer camps across the United States and teach girls 13 to 18 how to code. And we fully build out the entire program ourselves. We build curriculum, we create these really creative, dynamic classroom experiences, we train teachers.
So awesome. Karlie launched Code with Klossy in 2015 and is now in 25 cities and has had over 2,500 students. So it's remarkable
what you've
done in 5 years. So tell us, how do you think about sort of Code with Klossy going forward and continuing to build it and expand what you're already doing?
Yeah, there's so many ways that I want to keep building what we're doing. You know, I think the idea of expanding both domestically into new cities, but also globally, we want to build out more kind of robust skills and offerings for our scholars, because I think there's so much more that I think, like, even something we piloted this last summer was financial literacy. Mm-hmm. And these young women who are in our community and a part of Code with Klossy are so bright. They're so aware of, you know, the role that they play in the future that they want to see. And that they have infinite potential, and it makes me so proud to kind of be a part of helping them realize that potential. And, you know, I think that's one of the biggest byproducts that I'm most proud of with Code with Klossy, mm-hmm. is that, yes, we're kind of creating opportunities to learn how to code, but mm-hmm. also it's so much more.
So coding's not a world that, you know, has a ton of women in it. Tell us how that's been for you, and how you've been embraced by that community, and how, like, the public perception around your involvement in the community.
I think people were not expecting me to be interested in coding. And I think that's part of why maybe it got attention. Because, you know, just because I'm a woman that works in the fashion industry doesn't mean that I, A, can't learn these skills, or B, be interested in tech and business, and, you know, also realize how many ways these skills can actually be applicable to any industry. Mm-hmm. And that's what I really want to help other young women realize. Yeah, I mean, it's unfortunately primarily a male-dominated field, and, you know, I think there's a lot of reasons for that. I think there's a lot of barriers to entry. There's not enough access to learning opportunities. I went to a great public school in the Midwest, and we didn't have coding programs, but that's starting to change. I think another big factor is not having enough women in leadership positions that, you know, you can see and aspire to be.
Let's talk about mentoring. You know, mentoring is very important to you. You know, being a mentor, mentoring others, you know, as a model in tech and coding. Yeah. Tell us why you think mentoring is important and how you approach it.
You know, it's funny because like I said, you know, I graduated from high school. You know, I'm a part-time student at NYU, but I feel like the idea of being a mentor is something that you have to be at the end of your career, you have to be extremely accomplished, you have to have all the answers before you can help somebody else or before you can teach somebody else or be in that position to be a mentor. And I really don't think that's the case whatsoever. And I think the idea of just reaching out and you know, there's probably peers that you have maybe a little more junior here at the company or in other parts of your life, and being able to, I don't know, be vulnerable and share your learnings. And for me, I feel like a big part of the reason why my career has happened the way that it has is to do something meaningful with it. That's what really drives me. That's kind of the lens that I always think about what I want to do and why. I care to kind of make positive impact in the lives of others, especially young women. So, you know, I kind of accidentally ended up mentoring. But through Code with Klossy, you know, we have this amazing network and community of young women that actually really is kind of they support one another in big ways.
How would you describe what your personal brand is?
I never thought of myself as a brand. I think when I first started modeling, like I told you guys, you know, I'm from the Midwest. I have this kind of Cinderella experience in my career. I'm all of a sudden kind of traveling the world and having exposure to the greatest designers, the greatest photographers, and also because fashion is so interwoven into so many other industries, I was having exposure to, you know, the brightest minds in business and in tech and in art and music. And, you know, I think I really used that as an opportunity to learn and to, and I think that's one of the parts I love most about my job. But I think this idea of being a brand developed along the way as the opportunities for someone like me as a model evolved. I didn't set out on becoming a model to build a brand, because when I started, it was 2007. There was no social media at all. Like, now you're backstage at a show and there's a million cameras in your face and it's being live streamed and it's being tweeted and it's being, you know, there's so many things going on that nobody's actually present. You're like virtually kind of sharing where you are. But back in 2007, it was a very different kind of experience being in fashion. And but through this kind of evolution of social media, It's kind of given someone like me, who didn't prior have a voice, a platform to be able to show who I am, not just kind of be the canvas for a brand or a designer, but actually be able to kind of show who I am, stand up for what I believe in, say how I feel. And that was, I mean, it sounds trivial, but that was a really pivotal kind of moment, because I actually think to be, you know, even in the fashion industry or a model, you have to kind of define who you are and what you stand for as part of your brand. And actually, I see that as a huge opportunity.
So related to that, you know, you are you're masterful at social media. You sort of have to be. You have, I think, 8.5 Instagram followers.
That's
8.5 million.
Kind. Thank you.
It's a lot.
Do you guys ever get fatigued by social media? Yeah.
And
I have a love-hate relationship.
Well,
with
so
it.
That's what I wanted to ask you about. Yeah. So you have 8.5 million followers on Instagram. I think 6-ish million on Twitter. You know, there's good and bad that mm-hmm. comes with that. Tell us about the good. Tell us about the bad. How do you manage it?
I think, you know, like I said, there's huge opportunity to kind of use it as a platform. For me, I think about showing, like, who I am. I've always seen it as this opportunity to show the world who I am straight from, you know, my own voice and this kind of unfiltered relationship, which... again, just didn't exist. When I first started modeling, I was kind of seen through the lens of whatever photographer was shooting me, mm-hmm. whatever editor was styling, what magazine was kind of coming up with a story. So the idea of actually being able to just authentically show who I am through my social platforms was really liberating in a funny way. And I try and just be me. I try and just be authentic. I feel so grateful. I think that's the biggest factor, that I get to travel the world in a way that I never imagined. I get to see parts of the world, meet people that I just, I feel so grateful for those opportunities. So that was really a big reason why I wanted to start, like for instance, a YouTube channel. To be able to document that and share that in a more dynamic way.
So you're also the host of Project Runway.
Yeah.
And tell us what that's like. Tell us, you know, how you choose which designers, you know, you like or not. Just tell us about that experience. It's a whole other part of your life.
It's a whole other part of my life, but it's been really fun because, you know, I feel like the 12 years of experience I have as a model, kind of being in the room with the designer in the very kind of creative, collaborative process of bringing a look to life and seeing kind of all facets of the creation process. I have such an appreciation and respect for these designers. And I think that's why, the power of this show is that you can really see a window into the world of what goes on, how they kind of take an idea and realize it into a garment, you know, create a garment that walks down a runway. And there's a little bit of drama along the way, of course.
Always.
But it's, you know, for me, I really respect that creative process and I love the industry that I get to work in. So I wanted to kind of bring my experiences you know, be able to help guide these designers and really launch a career through this platform.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, so I have a bunch of lightning round questions
yes.
for you. Tell us the woman you most admire.
The woman I most admire would be my Gram. She just was the most influential woman in my life. My mom had breast cancer when I was young, and my Gram played a really... really important role in my and my sister's life.
Tell us your favorite person who follows you on Instagram.
Who follows me? Okay, honestly, Bob Iger is my favorite person who follows me on Instagram, and Jennifer Aniston.
Those are great.
I was like, oh my God, Jennifer, she's following me. Super fan.
Favorite person you follow on Instagram?
Ooh, Beyonce.
Totally.
Queen Bee.
Totally. Best advice you've ever received?
Ooh, you know, it's funny. I think about, so my dad, like I told you, he was an emergency room doctor, and he worked crazy long hours. He would work the night shift, and we would really only get to spend time with him during dinner. And so, you know, from like 6 p.m. we'd have dinner, then he'd go leave for work, and he would always ask my sisters and I, no matter what did you learn today? And I would always kind of go out of my way to make sure I learned something interesting to report back at dinner. And I think that, to me, just really kind of framed this idea of like always being curious always learning, always asking questions, whether it's something in school or outside of that. And I think that that actually was really impactful for the way I live my life. I definitely am always learning.
One piece of advice you'd give to anyone starting their career, either focused on engineering or finance?
A mentor of mine, Natalie Massenet, founder of Net-a-Porter, she gave me this piece of advice that has really come in handy personally and professionally, but kind of this idea of what would you do if you weren't afraid? Which, you know, I think this is a room of incredibly bright people, and I think this idea of, which I think is very human, we all get in our own way sometimes of being afraid to fail, being afraid to let somebody down, being afraid to make the wrong decision in our career, and this kind of idea of failure or fear that really holds us back and can be paralyzing. When Natalie said that to me, when she framed it like that, of kind of, if you remove that factor, if you remove that kind of like fear that is giving you knots in your stomach and you can't think properly, you can't breathe, when you remove that, what would you do? Or what would your decision be? And that's something I think about often. What would you do if you weren't afraid?
Such awesome advice. Yeah. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you so much.
This has been amazing. Thank you so much.